Hello, and thanks for watching Proactive New York. I'm joined by Nicholas Mersch. He's Portfolio Manager at Purpose Investments. Nicholas, it's really good to speak with you today.
Great. Thanks so much for having me.
So, Nicholas, we're chatting about two different markets, but two markets that have been, I suppose, facing the same challenges over the past few months. So it's the software market as well as the clean energy market. You put out reports recently on both of those markets. What are those challenges that they've been facing?
Yes, absolutely. And I think these two industries are frequently grouped together because they are in the growth equities component. And really what we're having is a lot of this macro over micro stories as of lately. And I think a lot of this is just due to the excessive amount of money printing that we've seen from a monetary policy perspective, which really have happened in terms of the Fed stepping in and really putting a backstop during that COVID period. And what we're experiencing now is the sort of the hangover effect, we'd like to call it. So what we did is we binged on way too much stimulus on the upfront side of after the COVID era. And what we're seeing now is a lot of that coming offline. And the result of this, the end result of this was inflation on a global scale. We had supply chain problems. We've had commodity spiking, as we've seen in the energy crisis, which is very, very much affecting the renewable market. And a lot of this inflation is really was deemed initially transitory, is much more structural in nature now. So we saw these inflationary readings come up and they keep on escalating. And as we're trying to get this sort of outline in terms of just how and when we see inflation peaking, a lot of these growth assets are struggling as the Fed comes in and really has these much more tighter monetary policies that are affecting these longer term duration assets. And what this is doing is really rotating a lot of the capital to much more safe haven assets and a lot more companies that are producing real assets as well. And we saw a lot of this sort of inflationary bubble that we saw specifically in the technology front really lift these assets into massive multiples on an EV to revenue basis that were really unsustainable in the long term. And a lot of this is now coming back to earth as we are seeing interest rates rise and the capital rotate towards those more free cash flow generative assets. And I think that these secular growers have just enjoyed so many tailwinds over the past couple of decades when really it was just a slow grind up and to the right because we had interest rates so low for so long. But as soon as those rates come up, these growth assets do get squeezed. And we're definitely seeing it on both the renewable energy aspect, which obviously has macro components as well from an energy instability and energy crisis perspective, but also a structural perspective in the technology names. And that it wasn't just the names that were caught up in this whole SPAC and spec tech sort of bubble here, where we saw pictures of rocks and JPEGs of rocks going for over millions of dollars. We saw some real technology companies with really enduring enterprise software fundamentals. They also got dragged down with the rest of the market. So a very, very sort of entire sector being pulled down by a lot of multiple compression, even though the fundamentals remain solid for a lot of these companies.
Mm. In fact, you say in the report for the software market that it was the worst first half start to a year since, I think, 1974 or since the early 70s. Do you see that continuing for the remainder of the year? Do you see any end in sight?
Yeah, so I think there's a very sort of interesting component here. And I think that the first half of the year, I would sum it up as sort of, thank God it's over. A very sort of rocky start to the year, specifically on the technology front. And the main component was multiple compression. So a lot of these high growth software companies, they were trading near the peak at 45 times EV to revenue. That multiple is now closer down to 8 or 9 times. So that is absolutely massive multiple compression on that front in terms of a lot of these assets just really getting the wind sucked out of them. But if you look at the fundamentals are the most important part here, because what happened over COVID is everything essentially shifted online. And a lot of the infrastructure needs to keep up with that. So a lot of these companies in our enterprise software ETF are focused on the plumbing of the system. So a lot of this cloud technology is being brought online and a lot of it accelerated through COVID, but you have to say, okay, let's look at the enduring trends here. For e-commerce, a lot of that growth was pulled forward and we're now seeing a lot of that growth being given back and they're going back to a lot of normalization. But when you think about the infrastructure cloud technology companies, that change is a lot more enduring because a lot of workflows are being pushed online and organizations figured they had to be more agile. And if you think about the overall labor market right now and just how tight it is, and wage inflation is just all over the headlines. If you think about software and its raw sort of capability form, what it essentially does is really reduce those labor costs because it increases the productivity of the average worker. And it really is the one of the best hedges against wage companies. So I'm not saying that these software companies are totally immune in a downturn. They are affected by these macro headwinds, but because their cost structures are not fixed and they're much more variable in nature, they can scale back on their sales and marketing or scale back on certain R&D expenses to really keep that the bottom line profitability. And we're going to see that over this next earning period, which is going to be very critical.
How about the fundamentals for the clean energy markets? And because I presume there may be some tailwinds as well as the headwinds they've been facing, but tailwinds as demand for renewable energy grows and kind of fossil fuels become more expensive or obsolete.
Absolutely. And I think there was this massive secular shift away from fossil fuels. And I think a lot of that had to do with the energy from both a solar and a wind perspective. So what it became was it wasn't this sort of hippie science project anymore. And I think human beings have to rationally be self-interested, and these companies have to be profit-seeking in order to properly allocate this capital, and they have to do so in an effective manner. So for me, it has to make money to make sense. And as much as all the positive effects of the overall environment make sense, are great in terms of the overall impact of these companies, what we're seeing now is them become a lot more feasible from a revenue and cost structure. But there's this whole adage in the solar industry that the sun doesn't always shine and the wind doesn't always blow. So what you need is battery technology to keep up with these companies. And if you think about battery costs, it used to cost over $90,000 and they used to weigh over 250 pounds to power one house. But now these cost closer to $7,000 and they weigh closer to 50 pounds. So the cost curves are coming down drastically when you introduce a lot of these battery companies onto these grids. And what we're seeing is a lot of grid instability. We saw massive sort of disruptions into the system as these grids failed sort of these resiliency tests. And as you have more distributed nodes from a battery front, you can more effectively optimize renewable energy. And as we've seen all these headlines, it's no sort of secret, and everybody's seeing just sort of the almost weaponization of energy and just how critically undersupplied the entire infrastructure is. I think this was a huge wake-up call to a lot of these companies say, okay, we have to go back to the drawing board and adding resiliency, increasing our renewable capacity within these infrastructures, and really weaning off the supply of certain countries. So we're seeing now the most recent headlines in terms of Russia really weaponizing Nord Stream 1, and sure, they might have listed it as a technical or mechanical error, but we all know it's more politicized than that. So if you think about the European energy crisis right now, and I think Dutch gas futures were up over 400% over the last couple of weeks, what you do have to add is a lot more resiliency in terms of the dependency of where you're getting these sources. So we've all woken up to this, but that being said, renewable really also had a big reckoning here, because we do still need fossil fuels in the interim as we sort of wean off. So that's why I think people need to revisit a lot of this nuclear capacity. And I think Germany is making a very critical policy and economic error not exploring that avenue more diligently. So we'll see where that goes and how that evolves. But I think just the overall fragility of the entire ecosystem has really been outlined over the last little while here, as certain energy sources have been weaponized from a sort of political perspective. The other point I did want to mention on the energy front is a lot of these inputs in terms of the solar panels themselves and the batteries as well, what they need is a lot of these raw materials. And over the sort of COVID supply chain crunch, what we saw are all these raw materials just spiking and going through the roof. And what this did was really make a lot of the producers have to absorb the cost of these rising energy, rising raw materials. And this squeezed their margins significantly. But what we're seeing over the last 2 months is a lot of these industrial metals are down significantly, down 30 to 60%, even since the last CPI reading. So we're seeing a lot of contraction on the input and raw materials front, which should be able to ultimately make these companies much more profitable, and they can more efficiently allocate capital after that.
Nicholas, very insightful. Thank you so much for your input today. I'm sure we'll be chatting to you again really soon.
Great. Thanks so much for your time.
That's Nicholas Mersch, Portfolio Manager at Purpose Investments.